Selected Writings and Speeches of Marcus Garvey. In honor of the return to America of the delegation sent to Europe and Africa by the U.N.I.A. to negotiate for the repatriation of Negroes to a homeland of their own in Africa. Africa is the legitimate, moral, and righteous home of all Negroes, and time is coming for all to assemble under their own vine and fig tree. Madison Square Garden, New York City, March 16, 1924. Fellow citizens, the coming together all over this country of fully 6 million people of Negro blood to work for the creation of a nation of their own in their motherland, Africa, is no joke. There is now a world revival of thought and action which is causing people everywhere to bestir themselves towards their own security, through which we hear the cry of Ireland for the Irish, Palestine for the Jew, Egypt for the Egyptian, Asian for the Asiatic, and thus we Negroes raise the cry for Africa, for the Africans, those at home and those abroad. Some people are not disposed to give us credit for having feelings, passions, ambitions, and desires like other races. They are satisfied to relegate us to back heap of human aspirations. But this is a mistake. The Almighty Creator made us men, not unlike others, but in His own image. Hence, as a race, we feel that we too are entitled to the rights that are common to humanity. The cry and desire for liberty is justified and is made holy everywhere. It is sacred, holy to the Anglo-Saxon, the Teuton, the Latin, and to the Anglo-Saxon it precedes that of all religions, and now come to Irish, the Jew, the Egyptian, the Hindu, and last but not least, the Negro, clamoring for their share as well as to their right to be free. All men should be free, free to work out their own salvation, free to create their own destinies, free to nationally build up themselves for the upbringing and rearing of culture and civilization of their own. Jewish culture is different from Irish culture. Anglo-Saxon culture is unlike Teutonic culture. Asiatic culture differs greatly from European culture. And in the same way, the world shall be liberal enough now to allow the Negro latitude to develop a culture of his own. Why should the Negro be lost among the other races and nations of the world and to himself? Did nature not make of him a son of soil? Did the Creator not fashion him out of the dust of the earth? Out of the rich soil which he bears such a wonderful resemblance, a resemblance that changes not even though the ages have flown. No, the Ethiopian cannot change his skin, and so we appeal to the conscience of the white world to yield us a place of national freedom among the creatures of present-day temporal materialism. We Negroes are not asking white man to turn Europe and America over to us. We are not asking the Asiatic to turn Asia over for the accommodation of blacks, but we're asking a just and righteous world to restore Africa to the scattered and abused children. We believe in justice and human love. If our rights are to be respected, then we too must respect the rights of all mankind. Hence, we are ever ready and willing to yield to the white man the things that are his, and we feel that he too, when his conscience is touched, will yield to us the things that are ours. We should like to see a peaceful, prosperous, and progressive white race in Africa or in America and Europe, a peaceful, prosperous, and progressive yellow race in Asia, and in like manner, we want and demand a peaceful, prosperous, and progressive black race in Africa. Is that asking too much? Surely not. Humanity, without any immediate human hope of racial oneness, has drifted apart and is now divided into separate and distinct groups, each with its own ideals and aspirations. Thus, we cannot expect any one race to hold a monopoly of creation and be able to keep the rest satisfied. From our distinct racial group of idealism, we feel that no black man is good enough to govern the white man, and no white man is good enough to rule the black man, and so of all races and peoples. No one feels that the other alien in race is good enough to govern and rule to the exclusion of native racial rights. We may as well, therefore, face the question of superior and inferior races. In 20th century civilization, there are no inferior or superior races. There are backward peoples, and that does not make them inferior. As far as humanity goes, all men are equal, and especially where peoples are intelligent enough to know what they want. At this time, all peoples know what they want. It is liberty. When a people have sense enough to know that they ought to be free, and that they naturally becomes the equal of all the other higher calling of man to know and direct himself. It is true that economically and scientifically certain races are more progressive than others, but that does not imply superiority. For the Anglo-Saxon to say that he is superior because he introduced submarines to destroy life, or the Teuton because he compounded liquid gas to outdo in the art of killing, and that the Negro is inferior because he is backward in the direction is to leave oneself open to the retort, thou shalt not kill, as being a divine law that sets the moral standard of the real man. There is no superiority in the one race economically monopolizing and holding all that would tend to sustenance of life, and thus causing happiness and distress to others. For our highest purpose should be to love and care for each other, and share with each other the things that our Heavenly Father has placed at our common disposal. And even in this, the African is unsurpassed, in that he feeds his brothers and shares with him the product of the land. The idea of race superiority is questionable. Nevertheless, we must admit that from the white man's standard, he is far superior to the rest of us, but the kind of superiority is too inhuman and dangerous to be permanently helpful. Such a superiority has and was shared and indulged in by other races before, and even by our own, when we boasted of a wonderful civilization on the banks of the Nile, when others were still groping in darkness. But because of our unrighteousness, it failed, as all such will. Civilization can only last when we have reached a point where we will be our brother's keeper. That is to say, that when we feel it righteous to live and let live. Let no black man feel that he has the exclusive right to the world, and the other man none, and let no white man feel that way either. The world is the property of all mankind, and each and every group is entitled to a portion. The black man now wants his, and in terms uncompromising, he is asking for it. The Universal Negro Improvement Association represents the hopes and aspirations of the awakened Negro. Our desire is for a place in the world, not to disturb the tranquility of other men, but to lay down and build and lay down our burden and rest our weary backs at the feet in the banks of the Niger and sing our songs and chant our hymns to the God of Ethiopia. Yes, we want to rest from the toil of centuries, rest of political freedom, rest of economic and industrial liberty, rest to be a socially free and unmolested, rest from lynching and burning, and rest from discrimination of all kinds. Out of slavery, we have come with the tears and sorrows, and now we lay them at the feet of American white civilization. We cry to the considerate whites for help, because in their midst we can scarce help ourselves, but we are strangers in a strange land. We cannot sing, we cannot play on our harps, for our hearts are sad. And we are sad because of the tears of our mothers and the cry of our fathers. Have you not heard the plaintive wail? It is your father and my father burning at a stake. But thank God there is a larger humanity growing among the good and considerate white people of this country, and they are going to help. They will help us to recover our soul. As children of captivity, we look forward to a new day and new yet ever old land of our fathers and land of refuge, the land of the prophets, the land of the saints, and the land of God's crown and glory. We shall gather together our children and treasures and our loved ones, and as the children of Israel, by the command of God, face the promised land. So in time, we shall also stretch forth our hands and bless our country. Good and dear America that has succored for us for 300 years knows our story. We have watered her vegetation with our tears for 250 years. We have built her cities and laid the foundations of her imperialism with the mortar of our blood and bones for 3 centuries. And now we cry for her to help. Help us, America, as we have helped you. We helped you in the Revolutionary War. We helped you in the Civil War. And although Lincoln helped us, the price is not half paid. We helped you in the Spanish-American War. We died nobly and courageously in Mexico, and we did not leave behind us on the stained battlefields of France and Flanders, and our rich blood to mark the poppy's bloom and to bring back to you the glory of the flag that never touched the dust. We have no regrets in service to America for 300 years, but we pray that America will help us for another 50 years until we have solved the troublesome problem that now confronts us. We know and realize that two ambitious and competitive races cannot live permanently side by side without friction and trouble. And that is why the white race wants a white America, and the black race wants and demands a black Africa. Let white America help us for 50 years honestly, as we have helped her for 300 years. Before the expiration of many decades, there shall be no more race problem. Help us to gradually go home, America. Help us as you have helped the Jews. Help us as you have helped the Irish. Help us as you have helped the Poles, the Russians, the Germans, the Armenians. The Universal Negro Improvement Association proposes a friendly cooperation with all honest movements seeking intelligently to solve the race problem. We are not seeking social equality. We do not seek intermarriage. We are hankering after the impossible. We want the right to have a country of our own and there foster and reestablish a culture and a civilization exclusively ours. Don't say that it can't be done. The pilgrims and colonists did it for America, and the new Negro, with sympathetic help, can do it for Africa. The thoughtful and industrious of our race want to go back to Africa because we realize that it would be our only hope of permanent existence. We cannot all together go in a day or a year or in 20 years. It will take time under the rule of modern economics to entirely or largely depopulate a country of a people who have been in residence for centuries. But we feel that with proper help for 50 years, the problem can be solved. We do not want all the Negroes in Africa. Some are no good here, and naturally will be no good there. The no good Negro will naturally die in 50 years. The Negro who is wrangling about the fighting for social equality will naturally pass away in 50 years, to yield his place to the progressive Negro who wants a society and a country of his own. Negroes are divided into two groups, the industrious and the adventurous, and the lazy and independent and dependent. The industrious and adventurous believe that whatsoever others have done, it can do. The Universal Negro Improvement Association belongs to this group, and so you'll find us working 6 million strong to the goal of an independent nationality. Who will not help? Only the man, the mean and despicable, who never to himself hath said, "This is my own, my native land." Africa is the legitimate, moral, and righteous home of all Negroes. And now that the time is coming for all to assemble under their own vine and fig tree, we feel it our duty to arouse every Negro to a consciousness of himself. White and black will learn to respect each other when they cease to be active competitors in the same countries for the same things in politics and society. Let them have countries of their own, wherein to aspire and climb without rancor. The races can be friendly and helpful to each other, but the laws of nature separate us to the extent of each and everyone developing by itself. We want an atmosphere all our own. We would like to govern and rule ourselves and not to be encumbered and restrained. We feel now just as the white race would feel if they were governed and ruled by Chinese. If we live in our own districts, let us rule and govern those districts. If we have a majority in our communities, let us run those communities. We form a majority in Africa, and we should naturally govern ourselves there. No man can govern another man's house as well as himself. Let us have fair play. Let us have justice. This is the appeal we make to white America.